seara. Până la urmă am tras biletul câștigătorului, vorbesc eu primul. Vă mulțumesc foarte mult că sunteți în această seară aici. Este un eveniment important și pentru noi, dar mă gândeam venind încoace pe drum că este un eveniment destul de special și pentru industria spectacolului din România într-un fel. Cred că e singura oară sau printre puțin unități în România când avem un câștigător de premiu Oscar care onorează premiera filmului lui în România în persoană. Și din această perspectivă îi sunt foarte recunoscător lui Laszlo Nemes că a acceptat invitația pe care am făcut-o. Sigur că am avut un liant foarte puternic în persoana lui Vlad Ivanov, dar noi care suntem o țară care apreciem din câte știm cu toții foarte mult această instituție a premiului Oscar, avem ocazia în această seară să cunoaștem un cineast din Europa de Est care a reușit să primească această distincție pe care o împlinește foarte multă lume din acest teritoriu geografic la o vârstă foarte tânără și cu unul din primele lui filme din carieră. Noi prezentăm în această seară cel de-al doilea film al său, care pe românește se cheamă Apusul și care va intra în cinematografie de săptămâna viitoare. Și dați-mi voie să încep cu concluzia. Mi-aș dori foarte mult ca cu ajutorul dumneavoastră care sunteți în această seară aici și care sper să fiți și la sfârșit când Laszlo Nemes va avea un Q&A, sper ca cu ajutorul dumneavoastră să ducem vorba despre acest film și să vină cât mai multă lume să-l vadă, pentru că avem ocazia rar să avem un cineast atât de talentat, atât de inteligent și atât de normal printre noi, după ce va fi primit o distinție de acest fel. Despre activitatea lui Laszlo Nemes și Q&A-ul la sfârșit, o să-l invit pe Andrei Tănăsescu să vă spună mai multe lucruri. El va fi entertainerul din această seară. Andrei.
Mulțumesc! Cristian, bună seara tuturor! O să schimb acum în engleză ca să ne facem înțeleși și pentru Laszlo. Like Christian said, we're extremely happy to have all of you here for the Romanian premiere of Sunset. Laszlo Nemes, as I'm sure a lot of you, if not all of you already know, was a filmmaker who made his feature debut in a Cannes competition back in 2015. It was a film that proved that Laszlo is an auteur of a visionary territorial force. For the film Son of Saul, which premiered in 2015 in Cannes, he won the Fipresci Prize and the Grand Prix. He, of course, also won the Oscar for the Best Foreign Picture in 2016. Last year in Venice, his follow-up, his sophomore film, Sunset, premiered in the Venice competition and won the Fipresci Prize. We're extremely happy and we're extremely proud, really, to have Laszlo here with us in the company of one of his main protagonists, Vlad Ivanov, who I'm sure all of you know. Like Christian said, they will both be here at the end for a Q&A, and I highly encourage all of you to stay engaged with Laszlo, with Vlad, and particularly with what you will see on screen, this magnificent piece called Sunset. So now, please help me welcome Laszlo and Vlad.
Thank you. Very touched and honored to be here tonight. Very moved to be next to this guy and that guy. It's a great honor. I was here in 2009 or 10, several times for short film festivals that, you know, called Next and Takino, and I already could feel the vibrant community that existed here in Romania that was interested in cinema and cinematic adventures. So I have a little history with the country, and when I started developing Sunset, actually before Son of Saul, in the process, I wanted to. I had this strange idea for a Hungarian film to cast this gentleman that I have a tremendous respect for, and I was longing to work with him for this film. So I'm you're going to say something, I guess.
Kérem, Michelin, jó estét kívánok! Ez a város nem magának való, itt most nem biztonságos.
He's good. And I want to pay homage to him because it was an extremely really difficult and I guess painful experience to learn this strange language for a movie, and he had quite a few lines. So thanks. I want to thank him for doing that, and so now we have this film. I just wanted to, we will have this Q&A. I won't be too long, but I just wanted to say one thing. You want to say something before I say my thing?
No, I'm okay. You're a guest.
Okay. I'm sure I'm forgetting something, but I want to say one thing is that it is a historical film and it's a period film. Everybody speaks English here, no? That's the country where everybody speaks more or less. But that's a good thing, as opposed to Hungary, where usually people don't speak any languages. So the thing is that you know, with period films, you have a certain way of looking at them, and I guess a way of doing them, making them. And I really didn't want to make a film that was in the conventional mode, and that I wanted to do something that was different and really could do a very personal journey. So I really hope that, first of all, you don't want to perceive it as a sort of, that you need a manual of history next to it, and that you can really dive with us into this very personal journey of the main character. So thank you for coming. Do I have to say anything else, or am I good to go?
I just want to say something else, because we assume that everybody speaks English, but if not, at the end of the film for the Q&A, I am going to translate the most complicated things, or somebody else will, for you in Romanian. But hopefully things are going to be clear after you watch the film. Thank you.
Nekem soha nem beszéltek róla.
Mit érdekel téged? Az egy vadállat.
Senki sem tudja, hol lehet most. Imádkozzunk, hogy ez így is maradjon.
Menjen el innen. Ezen a héten itt vér fog folyni.
Keine Angst. Kivakart a koszból.
Fölébresztettél minket.
Rejtve volt, napvilágra kerül.
Minden kezdődik előről.
Thanks. We stand.
We can sit.
No, I mean we don't. We sit. We stand.
Up to you. Clearly, I think we need a couple more kind of seconds to just let the film sink in and for us to kind of gather our thoughts.
More weeks.
It's definitely a film that will stay with everybody here, I'm sure. But to start things off, I wanted to ask you, Laszlo, your choice and decision to go back to this period in European history. You know, going back a couple of, 10, 15, 20 more years from your previous film, and why you chose to tell this story.
Yeah, first of all, when I said a couple more weeks, that's true. It's really, I think, not ideal to have a conversation immediately after the movie, because this is a kind of film that requires a little bit of, you know, internal work. But we're obviously we don't have 2 weeks, so let's do it now. Basically, I really wanted to go back to the birth of the 20th century in a manner that wouldn't be purely conventional and refusing the kind of logic that's very strong in cinema, this sort of the feeling that we have a feeling of distance and perspective and superiority over the period. How do you approach history if you don't want to use the conventional attitude, conventional, the codes? How do you take the audience back to a period that's important? I thought it was important, and that still matters to us, even if we don't really know. At a time when European civilization had an incredible promise, and yet chose at the crossroads, it seems, to destroy itself instead of building. When was the moment? And I think it's less of a historical question. It is, but indirectly, it's more like almost like a metaphysical question about the way we construct civilizations and the way we undo them. And can we find the traces of this willingness to destroy ourselves in our very hearts and souls? Can you do it in an non-conventional way? And that was the ambition of the movie, to approach it in a very subjective and immersive way, in a manner that would incorporate a quest to convey in cinematic terms the frustration and the obstruction and the limitations of the human perception and the way we perceive the world. So in a nutshell, yeah.
I think it's also a very timely film, apropos precisely of what you were speaking about, because, and you mentioned this before, I'm kind of paraphrasing, it is a stand-in for the same role that Yuli plays in Son of Saul. This is a person who came from an upper-class family, only theoretically, let's position the hypothesis that, you know, 10, 15 years later, she might find herself in Son of Saul. And this is a very timely film, I think, for where we stand as well in terms of Europe and where things are going. But I wanted to maybe talk a bit about, I'd rather ask you to perhaps speak more on this idea that, you know, the role of Yuli Yakov and the connection to Son of Saul.
Well, she was in Son of Saul. She had the only female part, which is kind of a glimpse of a female person coming to the main character out of the darkness of the barracks. And I think in that situation, you could feel the utter hopelessness of our civilization, in a way. And I really wanted to, you know, and when you put next to this her face, the face of Iris, it's the same, you know, the brilliant promise of a future in the streets of Budapest in the 1910s, obviously conveys something very, very positive and full of hope. And when you juxtapose the two images, these are. They cannot be reconciled, yet we talk about the same human being. So in a way, I think it's in retrospect, it's not I didn't do it really on purpose or consciously on purpose, but the fact that the films, it shows that the two films are linked. In many ways, there are many invisible bridges between the two films, and I see them as a part of one thing, in a way. So, yeah.
I would just like to commend you once again for bearing witness to really important moments in history, and you do it absolutely marvelously. But connected to Yuli Yakov, I wanted to also extend the question to Vlad, and you yourself, perhaps you could talk more about the casting process, which is very important, particularly for films, which bring you extremely close to the characters. Can you talk about how Vlad was cast, how you came into the film, and really, and also to move on from that, the experience of actually performing and acting in a piece like this, this grandiose piece of cinema.
Hogy gondolod magára, ha megőrösödik el?
No.
Yeah.
You can speak in Hungarian and then I can
translate. It was very nice. It was an amazing experience for me to starting from casting.
Okay.
A fost o experiență absolut minunată să primul să fiu invitat la casting de Laszlo. I'm talking about, I told you.
Don't worry, I will understand
it. I'll tell you after. Okay. Și mi-a dat un telefon, am avut o discuție pe Skype și mi-a spus că, Vlad, dragă, vreau să te invit la casting pentru un rol important în filmul meu și pentru asta aș dori să înveți trei secvențe, două mai mari și una mai mică în limba franceză și iar cea mai mică aș vrea să înveți și limba maghiară. Pe vremea aceea nu am găsit un coach pentru limba maghiară. Le-am învățat pe toate în franceză. Am ajuns la Budapesta, am cunoscut-o pe Iuli Iocob, pe Laszlo și i-am spus lui Laszlo că pentru că nu am găsit un coach pentru maghiară, voi face totul la în franceză. El a spus că nu e nicio problemă, numai că Iuli îți va vorbi în maghiară și tu îi vei răspunde în franceză. Și am spus, Iuli știe franceză? Nu. Eu știam că nu știu maghiară. Și atunci, cue-ul nostru în timpul castingului nu era că ea termina replica, că eu terminam replica și știam că trebuie să intru cu replica mea. Nu. Era un text extrem de elaborat, în care aveam tăceri, aveam pauze și în clipa aia s-a întâmplat absolut un miracol. Eram atât de... Asta a ținut de energia dintre mine și Iuli, practic dintre cele două roluri principale ale filmului, pe care această energie cred că o căuta și Laszlo. Și am încheiat cu bine castingul, nu mi-a venit să cred, și Laszlo, după casting, mi-a spus, Vlad, am asistat cu toții la un miracol. Pentru acest miracol, pentru că sunt aici și pentru că de față cu noi este Zito Vereștoi, care a fost cea care mi-a deschis calea către această limbă foarte frumoasă de altfel. Îi mulțumesc foarte mult. Ulterior a fost și Levente Molnar, care a fost și coachul meu în set, dar cu Zito Vereștoi am făcut munca cea mai grea. Țin minte că umblam cu textul în maghiară prin Chiselev pe aici, pentru că nu pot, așa funcționează ca actor, nu pot să învăț textul singur acasă. Mi se pare așa o muncă de birou și atunci am luat textul în mână și umblam prin, până să ajung la ora de maghiară, umblam prin parc și îmi spuneam tot textul înainte și zic tot timpul mă întreba, zice, tu vii la fix, tot timpul vii la fix. Zic, da, pentru că sunt în parc, învăț textul în parc și după aceea mă prezint fix la ora stabilită. La prima întâlnire, trebuie să spun asta, m-a întrebat, tu știi exact în ce proiect intri referitor la limbă, la procesul de învățare? Și am spus, știu că nu știu nimic și nu. Doar vreau să spun că, vorbind de cadrul de dificultate de învățare a limbii, limba maghiară este a doua după un dialect din sanscrita veche. Și am înțeles perfect că trebuie să fiu extrem de serios ca să pot învăța. După aceea, la Budapesta, televizorul a fost setat doar pe programele în limba maghiară, ca să am muzicalitatea limbii tot timpul zilei în urechea mea. După aceea, la filmare, sigur că eram cu echipa acolo și cred că a fost o perioadă de 3 luni de zile, atât cât au durat filmările, când am dormit cel mai puțin din viața mea, pentru că aveam textul pe noptieră, după ce învățam seara și pregăteam textul pentru a doua zi, mă culcam, mă trezeam peste o oră, vedeam lumina, luam din nou textul, îl spuneam din nou, iar mă culcam și asta se întâmpla de câteva ori pe noapte. Dar e o perioadă de care mi-aduc aminte cu foarte, foarte mare plăcere. Pentru că pot să spun acum, a fost una dintre cele mai profesioniste și frumoase echipe cu care am lucrat în film. A existat un respect pentru actor, pentru munca lui, pentru felul în care se dăruiește, încât a fost ceva... Și acum mă gândesc cum să-i răsplătesc. Vorbind acum și de Laszlo, am avut o secvență foarte grea cu Iuli în trăsură, când Brill Oscar, ați văzut secvența, Brill Oscar îi reproșează niște lucruri lui Iris și atunci decide să o trimită înapoi în Viena. Era o secvență foarte grea, foarte mare, în care aveam foarte mult text. Iuli a fost pentru mine un punct de echilibru în distribuție, cu o candoare extrem de greu de găsit în ziua de astăzi. Când eram amândoi în trăsură, mi-a strâns mâna și fără să spun absolut nimic și am știut că e cu mine acolo. Înainte de această secvență, Laszlo a vorbit cu toată echipa: vă rog să-i protejați, au o secvență foarte, foarte, foarte complicată. Astăzi Vlad nu vorbește maniară, vă rog să-l protejați, nu vorbește nimeni cu ei astăzi, lăsați-i în locul lor acolo să se concentreze. Asta au și făcut și am văzut oameni din echipă care cărau cabluri în vârful picioarelor. E momentul să le mulțumesc acum, așa cum ție, dragă Zito, îți mulțumesc din suflet, ai făcut o muncă extraordinară și trebuie să fie și momentul tău și l-am promis, pentru că...
I want to also ask about... Oh,
avem nevoie de traducere din engleză în română?
Nu.
Nu. Da? Bun, gata. Am relaxat.
I want to ask a bit about your choice, which was visible also in some of your choice of shooting very tightly with the main protagonist. But particularly in this film, this is a world that exists, that clearly exists, lives beyond the foreground. Do you want to a bit tell us how you built the sets, what you envisioned, how the world should essentially kind of grow and revolve around the characters? And also what it was like for the main protagonist to kind of operate within that world.
Well, the concept was that we wanted to immerse ourselves in the here and now, the main character, in the space, you know, share space and time with her. And I wanted, because I knew that I wanted the journey of the audience to be that we, you know, to share that experience with her. So for that, we actually created this Hestor, which was the center of this universe. We tried to find a pre-existing building in Budapest, we couldn't. So we built a Hestor in a vacant lot among buildings that exist, that still exist. And so actually it became sort of a set, movie set inside us, the very fabric of the city. So it's a mixture of you know, something constructed and something real. I really wanted to, if we go into the past or to have this feeling that we're in the city and we can go out and in front of the past or it's still the city, and actually, you know, the film is about to what extent we can have access to the truth, you know, of the world, if you will. I think that's something that has been at the center of the human human quest, even if now today with the internet we think it's more about the other things, but I think it's in the heart of that, and the film in a way shows I think in a more visceral way, that the more the main character tries to open the curtains around her, the more she finds new layers. So it's actually a film about layers and how, and our work was consisted of building the layers visually and in a on the sound level that would be, that would give a sort of mental perspective to the audience. And in the sense, it is a sort of sibling to Son of Soul because the perspective is mental, is never, is we have a hint of the complexity of this world, but you never have a full view of that. I really believe that cinema, and we should talk about this, but I really think that because of television, cinema has moved more and more away from any kind of subjective representation of the world to a more and more objective one. And it has become more and more a standardized understanding of the world. If you, and we can start with, you know, period films. I mean, you couldn't go to, I know about Holocaust films, you know, Holocaust films, usually if there's not a sort of bird's eye point of view on a camp, then we're disappointed. But then if you can encompass it all, then you can understand it all and it becomes simple. And I don't think that's how human experience is constructed, especially in very specific moments of history. I think we lack the keys to an understanding in the very moment when things happen. And that's the feeling that I wanted to convey. So for that, obviously it has production design elements, but also has aspects of assisting directing and organization of the shoot. You know, I knew I wanted to have many people around the main character. It's not only the directing is done in a way. It's almost like a dance or like a movement of the planets. And we're with the main character in orbit, and we are, and everything is revolving. It's like a perpetual movement, and everything is changing. So you cannot really catch it never really stops. So there's always some kind of frustration at work, and we wanted to work with that. And so we had to organize everything. You know, even for extras, it's complicated, especially in Hungary. I mean, in the US it's different, but in Hungary, extras don't come to the close to the camera. You know, they are scared of the camera, obviously. They start running when they see a camera. So we really had to, you know, we had dancers, we're very close to the camera. It's something like that. So we really wanted to create this sense of closeness of Iris to these faces, because these are this is her world, this is her quest of finding this brother of who will give her the key, the ultimate key to oil her understanding. And there's always this confusion of faces, and that was in the very heart of the approach. So just opening some possible perspectives. I could talk about it for longer, but I will not right now.
And Vlad, how is it for you to exist in this universe? To exist in the universe?
Yeah. No, it's okay.
I have a very good translator.
Thank you. The best one. Am discutat de foarte multe ori cu Laszlo, am avut sesiuni pe Skype cu el, în care mi-a explicat foarte precis și foarte atent despre epoca pe care vrea să o evoce în film. Ulterior am fost invitat la Budapesta, am discutat face-to-face cu el și mi-a sugerat să citesc 5 cărți despre perioada în 1900, Budapesta în perioada acelor ani. Lucrul ăsta m-a ajutat foarte tare și ușor-ușor am reușit să aduce în plătere personajului aproape de ce, resortul interior, practic de ceea ce își dorea Laszlo. Mă întrebesc că a fost prima oară când am avut șansa ca în preproducție, înainte de filmare, să avem o săptămână în care am făcut, respectiv echipa Laszlo, teste de cameră, de obiective, de încadraturi, de mișcare, de lumină, de absolut tot. O săptămână care a fost extrem, extrem de necesară pentru acest film și lucrul care a fost foarte interesant pentru mine ca actor în film a fost să integrez camera ca pe un personaj, pentru că erau secvențe care începeau dintr-un POV al meu sau lui Iulie. După aia venea în prim plan, se mișca printre actori și toată această coreografie minunată care era creată și care era foarte repetată ca să poată ieși foarte bine, cerea exact acest lucru, să asimilez camera ca pe un personaj, nu ca pe un obiect rece care te deranjează pe tine ca actor. Sigur că aveam și alte sarcini, mi-am dorit foarte tare în acest film să nu doar să vorbesc corect cum urește și să spună toți din Ungaria sau toți din Budapesta, wow, Vlad, vorbește la ungurește. Nu mi-am dorit lucrul ăsta, mi-am dorit să joc în maghiar. Să joc în maghiară. La un moment dat, țin minte că Laszlo a venit la mine, era o secvență supraîncărcată și mi-a spus, mai pus să faci o dublă? Mai pus să faci o dublă? Și eu sunt ok, zic, nu, mai vreau o dublă. Și mi-a dat o indicație fantastică, uită de limbă, fă, du-te numai pe actorie. După aia o să vedem ce să facem la dublaj. Și munca asta, am început inițial cu ideea de a nu fi dublat, dar sigur că ulterior, datorită unui accent care a existat, au luat decizia producătorului să fie dublat. Dar fără această muncă extrem de serioasă și laborioasă, dublajul ar fi fost extrem de greu.
Well, congrats for the movie. Of course, there are no words to tell you. Great camera work, great lines, great screenplay, great coloring. But I wanted to tell you, to ask you if this was your intention to make us feel what being a woman meant at that time. Because me as a woman, beyond the film and beyond the film specialist, I felt if women had no word to say. They were just meant to be beautiful and to sit and stay where they were meant to stay, and they have had no life, no independence, and no way of their own. So this is what you wanted to show?
Well, first of all, I have two thoughts. First of all, I had an access to the 20th century through my grandmother, and she was my only link to the past. She lived through the century, and she was born in 1914, and lived through an entire century. And I would always ask her about you know, the hardships of the history that she had to endure and endure in her very flesh. And that was very moving, I think, for me as a kid to have this kind of access. And so I think she's in there in this kind of very peripheral position that is extremely extremely reduced in terms of access to the main flow of history. You know, she has to endure it, but she doesn't. She cannot really, you know, understand it. Well, obviously, when she is pregnant in 1945, then in the middle of the war, and she has to hide and things like that. Obviously, this the motherhood, the aspect of motherhood, is much stronger for me as a, you know, in terms of of the incredible fate of this century and the people in it. For me it's very personal. It just it becomes subjective. I don't really have a feeling that I have to talk about feminine condition. And I know it's very trendy to oppose men and women. I am much more interested in how we are intertwined. And this film is very much about that, you know. This woman who has a brother who is a shadow of herself, and I see it as a sort of double, the way they are intertwined, mixing in a way that's very hard to separate. That's something that I really was interested in. So it's more, I would say it's, I'm a little bit out of this, I think I have a little different perspective on things, because I tend to step back and a little bit see. I try to see in terms that are not reduced to only topical things, but more of a human condition based approach, or metaphysical or humanistic approach. Try to, at least.
It should also be said that you co-wrote this film with Clara Rey, who also co-wrote some song with you.
Yes, we did.
Yeah, and I think there's a very interesting, I mean, one could also maybe perhaps even extend that analysis, the fact that Iris always comes out of the shadow, and she has to take on the clothing of a man to observe the movement, the social movement that is about to come. And she is the one who is actually will always be in the background, the woman to support and to be the pillar who observes the change of history. I mean, the woman has a very, very important role and position in the film.
Yeah, for example, in Ulysses, you have the last part of Ulysses. It's a female monologue, and it's Molly Bloom's monologue, and it's the most touching piece of literature I ever read. And and it was written by a man, so I have no feeling that I am not entitled to talk about women. You know, it's very trendy to say that only women can talk about women and men about men, and then it doesn't end, because we're not human beings anymore, but we're fragmented some things. So I guess this film is also about this being intertwined, and I think that's definitely not topical in this way, but in a very different way.
Hogy fedezte fel Vlad Ivanovot, és miért pont őt választott? Cum l-a descoperit pe domnul Vlad Ivanov și de ce l-ați ales chiar pe el?
Can I answer in Hungarian? In English?
Yes.
Because Hungarian would be problematic for some. I always thought that he would be right for the part. From the beginning, I tried to cast a Hungarian actor, but I couldn't find anybody better than this guy. I had his face when I wrote the part, so in my mind, and I saw him in films in which I found him extremely powerful, such as Christian's films, and. So I just found that he had this sophistication and yet something also very powerful, mysteriously dangerous. That these potential elements that I really found in him, in as a human being, and I when I met him, I really enjoyed being around him, which is a good sign that you know, actors usually, if I don't have the human connection with them, I tend not to establish well a good communication, because I don't feel the human being, and with Vlad, I immediately felt that there was a very deep form of communication that was based on human values, and that And that's how we called him. And we were so glad that he was ready to
answer.
Do that part.
The answer.
And he did. Picked up the phone.
Let's see if anybody else has a question. I would definitely want to bring up the fact that this is the second film that you shoot on 35, and in particular, maybe you could speak more about the closing scene, but primarily your choice of shooting on film, which I think also speaks to the film language that you use. And then maybe you can also mention the closing scene as well.
Closing scene. Yeah, it's too bad you couldn't see it on its intended format. I hear that you cannot screen on 35 in this country anymore, which is like a big shame, I have to say. And I'm very sad to learn that, because I think that it's like putting high resolution photocopies in your museums of paintings and say, oh, nobody will see the difference anyway, so just take, you know, the audience for stupid people. And I'm just very concerned about this whole digitalization of cinema. Actually, we were talking about this with Christian, and I'm sure digital can allow us blah blah blah, but the thing is that for me it's very personal. The magic of cinema is linked to the image that's physical, that's material, that's chemical. And let's put aside the question of quality, which is, well, there's no question about quality, obviously. I don't believe that people feel immediately if they see a film. But it's more like a physiological experience to watch a movie, because you're half of it, you're in darkness. And the still images become movement in your head. So it's magic. In a way, that's the sort of magic that we... You know, the opening scene, is the credit scene of the film is Streets of Budapest. It's just a postcard, and we painted it. But it's actually the way the light changes. We shot it on 35. It's actually based on a device I saw in a museum of cinema. It's sort of a peep box. You would look into, it's like from the 16th, 17th century. You would watch a perspective of an Italian city, and you would have light in the background that would change from night to day and to night to day. And you could watch it for hours and hours, because we as human beings, we are enthralled by things that are simple yet physical, but there's light that's contained in them, our physicality is contained in them. And the problem with digital is that it becomes, not only it's volatile and it cannot be archived, but it's also it's virtual, and everything is about information, and there's no room for, you know, there's no room for uncertainty. It's not flickering with uncertainty. It's not moving with uncertainty. The problem is that under the pressure of projector makers and chip makers, we have transferred with incredibly great European political pressure. We have scrapped the 35mm projectors throughout Europe, and said it's a great, you know, it's like coming from, you know, the order coming from the central party saying that let's craft the projector we have much better, which is bullshit, because these projectors are dead in 2 years, obviously. And scrapping machines that are about, you know, can do something for 75 years, 100 years, for machines that can do things for 2 years and in a lesser way, and then you fire the projectionist because we don't need anybody who needs it, you know, who knows anything about anything. It just pushes the button. I think that symbolizes the entire highway that we all wanted to rush onto with great joy. And I think it's just strange that all the digitalization corresponded to a simple to a standardization of the cinematic process of directing. You know, some directors obviously will have the discipline to shoot only what they want to shoot, but let me tell you, that's not the tendency. The tendency is to machine gun everything. And it's the overall thing. If you can do it easily, shoot 700 hours of footage, and then it becomes not directing for me. I think it becomes more of a redacting job. And you don't make the decisions before and on the shoot you make decisions. You push everything to the editing process. And I think that's, well, I think it has resonance throughout the entire industry, throughout the entire creative process. But the thing is that the language, you know, slowly, I think the language of cinema is less and less questioned because of this. And it's more and more standardized because of this. The colors look more and more like the same, and so on and so forth. I could speak about it for hours. I will not, but I feel very strongly about it. It's not because digital shouldn't exist. It's just that it doesn't allow film to exist. That's the only problem. It doesn't allow thing, and we paid with the tax money to make a system in which the audience will pay the same amount of money for something that's less good, but they would, it's television in public, and then I presented my case. I will not go further, but I just feel that it's so sad that we cannot project on film anymore in Bucharest. It's so sad for me.
In particular, because the closing scene was shot on 65.
Yeah, that's the tricky thing. It actually had to go through a computer, so we actually had to downgrade it. But it's actually on 65. Yeah. If we could project on, we're not going into technical details because everybody's gonna fall asleep more than they are already. So that's not good.
That being said, Laszlo, Vlad, thank you very much for really shining a light for us.
Thank you. Thanks
on many aspects. And thank you all for coming.
Thank you.